Morning, welcome to Lockwood. Hope you have a great weekend ahead of you and glad you can be with us today. Got several things going on today, so I'm not going to go through all the announcements like we normally would, so please pick up a bulletin or check your email for the Lockwood update. But just very briefly, next week is Change Your World. Be sure to bring in change for that. That's going to Spectrum. Directory project is going ahead, so be looking for emails and information on that. The elders are presenting a couple of men to be elders. One of them you'll hear from later on, Mike Arnold this morning, and the other one is Bob DeBolt. I'm sure most of you know him, but be thinking and praying through that. Tonight at the Northview Christian Church is an evening of praise and worship, if you'd like to take part in that, at 6 o'clock. Information about providing meals, they're looking for people to help with that or with the landscape committee. Take note of that, get your bulletin, read about that. And then the last couple of things is March 6th, there is a Lockwood Family Ministry bowling event going on. If you want to know about that, see me or call me. And then lastly is next Sunday after the second service at 12:30, 1 o'clock, well, probably 12:30, not 1 o'clock, you'll all leave by then, is we are going to be casting the vision of what children's ministry may be looking like, all right? And the reason I say maybe is because that will be a community, a group effort. It's not just about me and what I think. Everybody said amen. But next Sunday, if you think that the Lord might be calling you to take part with us in that endeavor and part of that community, come to the luncheon. It will have a main meat provided, and then asking everyone else to just bring a side dish to pass, and then I will be talking about what that will look like, sharing with some of the people that have been helping me talk through that, work through that, and then have a question and answer time so you can understand it better. So that's what's coming ahead. I think that's everything for announcements.
If you would please pass the registers on the sides of your rows. Let us know that you're here this morning. Our call to worship is from Romans chapter 8. It's verses 14 through 17. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves again to fear. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Let's sing together, Children of the Heavenly Father.
Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in his bosom gather, nestling bird nor star in heaven, such a refuge there was given. God his own doth tend and nourish, in his holy courts they flourish. From all evil things he spares them, in his mighty arms he bears them. Neither life nor death can ever from the Lord his children sever. Unto them his grace he showeth, and their sorrows all he knoweth. Praise the Lord in joyful numbers, your protector never slumbers. At the will of your defender, every foeman must surrender. Giveth or he taketh, God his children never forsaketh. Is the loving purpose solely to preserve them pure and holy?
Let's pray together. Lord, we take comfort in you as our Father. We take comfort in your guidance. We take comfort in your word. We take comfort in the fact that you will guide us through every trial. You will guide us through every tribulation, that you never leave us, you never forsake us. We are yours because you made us yours. Help us to stand confidently in your grace. Grow us in that grace and reveal yourself to us today as we worship, as we pray, as we hear your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue worshiping. Thank you.
life. Let it become your throne, unbroken. And let my life outweigh my
I think it's working. Ah, good. Yesterday it did not work for us, so we're grateful for that. It's good to be with you again, as you can tell. I'm not Shayne. I'm not that tall. And you can tell because the length of the cord almost goes to my feet. So we'll just pray that I don't trip. In the New Testament, we're specifically told many times over and over what Jesus came to do. And that is so that we can discover a little bit about what God would have us to become. And we know Jesus, when he was here on earth, never left people the same way that he found them. So it is my hope today that we will get to see an example of the kind of life that God desires us to live, so as to help us become everything God would have us become. Now our scripture opens this morning, and I'm going to take my glasses off so I can read better, is Hebrews 9:10, and it's translated from the Living Bible. For the old system dealt only with certain rituals, what foods to eat and drink, rules for washing themselves, and rules about this and that. The people had to keep these rules to tide them over until Christ came with God's new and better way. Underline or highlight or whatever you do if you're taking notes, Christ came with God's new and better way. See, Jesus came to replace rules with relationships. And we praise the Lord for that. Up until now, up until the time of Jesus, I should say, people thought the right way to relate to God was by keeping the law or keeping a bunch of rules. Jesus said, that's not the way. Oh, no. The way you rightly relate to God is by having a relationship with him through faith. Amen? No, this is participation. Amen? Now, what a tough crowd. And there's a great example of this in the Gospel of Mark, and I will read that for you. Mark 10, 17 through 23. Most of you know the story, I'm sure. And it's about the rich young man or rich young ruler, depending on which gospel you are in. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Good teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not have false testimony. Do not defraud. Honor your mother and your father. And he says, teacher, all these I have kept since I've been a little boy. Jesus looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack, he said. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. And may he add a blessing to you for the hearing of his word this morning. We discover, as we walk through these verses, several things. First, this is rich young man, or ruler, was holding on to three beliefs about God and how to relate to God. The problem is, they were all wrong. He didn't really understand what Jesus came to do. And I don't want any of us here today to have any of these mistakes or make any of these mistakes. So we're going to go over three mistakes that this young man made. And mistake number one, what I have and who I am is enough to have a right relationship with God. Now, this story is told in three of the four Gospels. And if you read all three of them together, you'll find three words that come forward: rich, young, and ruler. Now, this man had a lot of going for him. First, he was rich. It is clear that he had more than enough material possessions. And quite often people will read this story and come to the conclusion that Jesus is saying that all money is bad. But that's not true. That's not what the story is about. The story is about the wrong attitudes toward money. That's what can be the problem. But money, in and of itself, has many good benefits. It has been said that money is like fire. It has tremendous potential for good and for evil. Amen or oh my. Next, we are told that this young man, that this man was young, and I believe that we were told this fact to indicate he had a lot of potential. And for some of you, that is true. Those who have more years ahead of themselves than they have behind them. Amen? Potential. That's what we're looking at. It means that there is an upside. There is much that can be accomplished. There is a bright future ahead. And I believe Jesus saw that in this young man, there was much potential. So he had financial resources. He had a bright future. Last, we're told that he was a leader. Now, we don't know what kind of leader he was. Jesus doesn't really go into any of those details for us. But he could have been a ruler in the community in which he lived, or he could have been a religious leader or teacher, or maybe he was even a political leader. We're just not sure. But we do know that he had position and authority. So, this young man had financial resources, he had a bright future, and he had lots of influence. Now, beyond those three facts, we know a little bit more about this young ruler through the context of the story. We know that he was a humble man. The Gospel of Mark said that when he came up to Jesus, he fell to his knees right in front of Jesus, and he asked the question about eternal life. We also learned that this man was spiritually sensitive. And a lot of people who were rich and young, or are rich and young, they don't think about religion. They don't think about life after death. They don't think about heaven or eternity. A lot of them don't even think about the near future. But this guy wanted to know about life and death. He wanted to know how he could have eternal life. You see, he wanted to have a right relationship with God in heaven, as I believe most people do. And we also know that he was a moral man. Jesus names off four or five of the Ten Commandments, and this guy says, hey, I've kept all of these since I was a little boy. See, he had a real good system in his mind of what was right and wrong, a religious system of morality, keeping the laws and the rules of Judaism. Now, I believe the mistake is believing he had enough and accomplished enough and was moral enough and was good enough to be considered, at least in his own religious mind, good enough for God and eternal life. Now, we have to admit, this guy did have a lot going for him. Yeah. Most of us probably admit he was very moral and ethical and upright. Thus, he easily could have believed this might be enough to have eternal life, as many people do today. You know what I'm talking about. But Jesus looked at the man and he told him, "You're still missing something. That's not enough." I can imagine this young ruler going, "Ouch, that hurts." But I think at that point, the rich young ruler shifted to his second mistaken belief. Mistake number two is, if what I have isn't enough, I can do more to earn my way into heaven. It's clear from reading the story that this young leader at least suspected that his level of morality and his money and his religion had its limitations, so that he still might need to have just a little bit more. And thus the question, "Good teacher, what must I do?" And you can insert "more" to inherit eternal life. Many of us make that mistake. Now in Isaiah 64:6, it says this: "We are all infected and impure with sin when we proudly display our righteous deeds. We find that they are all but filthy rags." Circle "all" or highlight it, underline it, whatever you do when you're taking notes. Circle "all." Then in Romans 3:23, and you all know this one, I'm sure: "For we all have sinned and fall short of God's glorious standard." Now the root word for in Greek for sin is harmatia. And what that means is that it's an archery term, and it means missing the center of the center of the bullseye. In other words, perfection. None of us, no matter how good we are, ever make perfection of God. So we'd have to agree that it is sin that keeps us from heaven, and we are all in the same boat. We all fall short of that perfection. We are all sinners. Our own righteousness is nothing more than filthy rags. Thus the answer: there is nothing we can do or do more to be saved. There is nothing I can do or you can do to go to heaven. We cannot earn our salvation. Amen? Explain it this way: the rich young ruler had tried a variety of ways to please God, but he fell short. And it's kind of like us trying to jump across the Grand Canyon. Now, some of you in here can jump a lot farther than I can. And no amen to that one. But we all have the same conclusion. We're not going to make it. No matter how far you can jump, we're all going to fall short. So this guy had tried to get to God by keeping a lot of rules. This young ruler had tried to get to God by following a lot of religious rules. He tried to get to God by doing good and being good. But Jesus said that's not enough. Ephesians 2:8-10 says this: "God saved you by his special favor," or another word that we use, grace, "when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God." Highlight that. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for good things that we have done or that we are doing. Why? So none of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do good things that he planned for us a long time ago. Praise the Lord. Amen. So since our rules, our rituals, our religion won't get us closer to God, God had to come to us. And he came in the form of man, Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. And we are all grateful for that, and we can give thanks. Romans 3, 21 through 25 says this, "Now a new righteousness from God apart from the law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness," underline this righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. And we are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. For God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith on his blood. So Jesus says to this man and to all of us, come, follow me. Accept him for who he is. Accept his work upon the cross and the grace of God. Jesus calls everyone, come, follow me, and receive the free gift of salvation. Amen and amen. What a gift. But this young, rich young ruler believed that he could do more to get to heaven, and he found out he was wrong. And he makes one more mistake that maybe some of us are making here today. And that's mistake number 3. He believed, I can trust Jesus with part of my life and still be completely with God, or complete with God. In our culture, we have come to falsely believe that as long as we give God some of our life, part of our life, we have the right to hold on to maybe some others. We believe God doesn't have anything to do with some of those parts. But that's a wrong belief. That is a mistake. It's a mistaken belief. Jesus wants all of you. He wants every part of your life. And our life is in this culture is like a bunch of boxes or compartments. I have my work compartment. I have my home compartment. I have my church compartment. I have my relationship compartment. I have my everyday compartment. I have my church friends. I have my secular friends, etc., etc. Whatever little boxes you have for your life. You say to God, I want you to have all of my life except this one. We all want to hold on to different areas of our life that we like and that we enjoy and that we're comfortable with. Amen or oh my. If we are honest with ourselves, there are areas of our life that we still want to control. We don't want to give it over. And maybe it's in the area of relationships. And we know if we commit totally to God, he might ask us to give up some of those relationships. And we're not really ready to do that. Or maybe it's the compartment that we want to control is money and finances. Or maybe it's our busy schedule or how we use our free time. Or I have my own agenda and I want to control it. And I want to use it how I want to use it. Or maybe this is your deal. Maybe you have trouble trusting God with your past compartment. And you say to God, you saw how ugly my past was. It's too hard to have a trusting relationship with you. Or you may even think, I'm not sure I can trust God with my future. After all, I know what I want to do. I have plans. What is your compartment that you're still hanging on to? Folks, here's the truth. You can bank on it. If Jesus is God, Son, and he is, if he died on the cross to prove his love for you, and he did, if he rose from the dead, proving his identity and his power, and he did, wouldn't you agree that he deserves your full devotion? He wants all of your life. He wants us to have a loving, trusting, caring relationship with each and every one of us. Jesus wants you to trust him with everything. And that's when we can call him Lord. 2 Chronicles 16:9. The eyes of the Lord search the whole earth in order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Underline, highlight, whatever you want to do. Hearts that are fully devoted to him. Our scripture says that when Jesus touched that one compartment of the rich young ruler's life, that he was unwilling to give it up. And the rich young ruler turned and he walked away sad. What might have been? Think about that. What might have been for this rich young ruler if he would have gave it all to Jesus? Amen? Well, you lost you, didn't I? Jesus came to replace rules with relationships. In other words, you can't be good enough and you cannot earn your salvation. And in our story, Jesus wasn't interested in the man's money. What he really wanted from this guy was his love, his undivided devotion, a new relationship, a loving relationship, a caring relationship. But it came down to a battle of self. The rich young ruler was saying, "What do I want?" instead of, "What does God want?" And there was this war, this raging war inside, a battle like a spiritual tug of war. And the rich young ruler saying, "This is what I want." But Jesus saying, "This is what you need." The truth? We were created for those relationships. And like any good relationship, we need to give our all. And I want to close with this short story. And there was this 6-year-old little girl who was at a discount store with her mother, and she saw this string of fake pearls, costume pearls, and they were just cheap. And they became the delight of her eyes, and she began to beg her mother for these pearls. But her mom says, "No, we don't want to waste our money on fake pearls." But as little children do quite often, not just little girls, but begged her mom, "I'll spend my own money for it." So her mom finally gave in, and the little girl reached into her purse and pulled out every dime and nickel and penny she had till she came up with $3.16. Purchased those pearls. Now the little girl loved these pearls. She wore them every day to kindergarten. She wore them every day to school and first grade. And she did every day to second grade. She wore them out to play. She wore them in the bathtub. She wore them when she went to bed. She really loved these pearls and hardly ever took them off. Well, a couple years later, her daddy was tucking her into bed, and as he finished, he said, "Sweetheart, do you love your daddy?" And she said, "Daddy, I love you." And he said, "Would you give me your pearls?" So she thought for a while, and finally she said, "Would you take my rocking horse instead?" The next night, he was tucking her into bed again, and he said, "Sweetie, do you love your daddy?" And she said, "Daddy, I love you." And he said, "Would you give me your pearls?" This time she didn't think. She quickly said, "Would you take my dowel?" This went on for several nights. until a couple weeks later, after going through this ritual every night, he asked the same thing, "Do you love me?" And she said, "Daddy, I love you." He said, "Would you give me your pearls?" And she didn't say anything. So the dad turned and started to walk out the door, and the little girl hopped out of bed, her little fist, her little hand in a fist, and she went over to her daddy and she says, "I have something for you." And she opened up her hand. "Here's my pearls." And he said, "Sweetie, I've been waiting a long time for that." Then he reached into his pocket and he pulled out a velvet pouch and gave to her a string of authentic pearls. And he said, "I was just waiting for you to give up your dime store stuff so I could give you a true treasure." See, Jesus came to replace the rules with loving relationship. But the question really this morning is, what do you need to let go of to really experience that type of relationship? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, who came to replace rules and religion with a loving, caring relationship. And for those who have placed their faith in him, may we be like that little girl and give up our worldly junk and give our all, every compartment of our lives, give it up so as to enjoy that wonderful relationship that is far greater than anything we have experienced in this world. Part your blessings on this congregation. And as we go through another week, bring us along. Teach us as we claim it in the name of Jesus. And in his name we pray, and all God's people said, Amen. Thank you, and you are dismissed.